our hearts will be lifted up above the mundane into the place of the spiritual, so that we won't look at what the world predicts. We won't look at what the world promotes. Instead, we'll look at what the Word of God lays out as truth and all the exponential possibilities that exist as we trust in the Lord. And so, as is our new custom, we will be sending out the scripture message for today in the morning of the activity. So if you get a text or a call from the church, listen to it if you want to get the scripture a little early so that you can kind of get a chance to study it yourself. I should have done that. Sister Bowman actually presented that idea, and I think it's a great idea so that we can study and be on point together. So again, I'm grateful for all of our participation, and all those who are calling in on a very regular basis. And I thank God for those who call in when you can. And so we pray tonight that we open up the Word of God, and in the book of Psalms, the 30th Psalm, these words to strengthen us and cause us to again be reflective of all that God has done for us and all that God is able to do for all those his people. So in the 30th Psalm, we remember, it says in the heading, if you have a King James Version, some other translation, it says, a psalm and song is a dedication of the house of David. This song was penned for the very purpose of dedicating the house of David. And it's always interesting when I look back, that when David, built his new house, before he did that, he dedicated a place for the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant, of course, as we remember, represents the very presence of God. And what David wanted, and I find this, which is indicative of why he was known as the man after God's own heart. David's love for God, David's desire for God was not selfish. He did not just want to feel God and experience the fullness of God himself. He wanted others to experience God and the fullness of God himself. So when he got situated as king, one of the first things he did was to make sure that the Ark of the Covenant was brought back from Philistine, where it had been for a period of time, to bring the Ark to the place where he was dwelling, so that it'd be one worship place for all of the people of Israel. So he brought the Ark back. And the Bible says, if you get a chance to read this in 2 Samuel, initially, they brought the Ark back, and in bringing the Ark back, there was an initial issue. Let me see if I can put it like this. The Philistines carried their idol god on a cart that was drawn by oxen. That's what they did, and that was their culture. And when the children of Israel got the Ark back under David's leadership, they wanted to carry the Ark as what they had seen other people do, and particularly the Philistines. And so they put the Ark on a cart, and they put oxen before the cart, and they put a man named Uzzah and a name named Ahio, who were kind of supervising the transfer of the Ark of Covenant to the place that had been designated by David to be the place where they could have a corporate worship of God. But what happened was that they were pushing the cart pulled by the oxen hit a rock, and the ark became unstable. And as a result, the Uzzah reached back to the side of to steady the ark, and as a result, he died. And David was hurt. David was displeased. The Bible says that David was afraid of the Lord because David probably couldn't understand why God would kill this man, because as this man was simply doing what it was, bringing the Ark of the Covenant into the presence of God's people. And so David was afraid, and so David ordered that the Ark be taken down to a place called Kirjath-Jearim, to a man named Obed-Edom's house. And for those who used to be in the Thursday night class, remember Obed-Edom was a man, they just randomly selected, apparently. But what we recognize is random is not random when God's involved. And so they took the Ark to Obed-Edom's house, and 3 months later, the report came to David saying, hey, David, guess what? Obed-Edom is being blessed. His whole household, everybody come to his house, all his neighbors, visitors, everybody being blessed, is because of the presence of the Ark of the Covenant. So David decided then, because David was afraid, and David just didn't know what to do, but David decided then to move the Ark to the place that he desired that it be moved to. But what David did this time was not allow the world view, or the Philistines view in this place, to determine how he operated in God's presence, but he went back to the Word of God to determine, to find out how God wanted the Ark to be transported. And what he realized, and it's not that it was the first time, but it was just he had gotten so caught up that they just decided to do what was expedient. I want to watch this right here. They did what was expedient. They put it on the Ark, put a man on the Ark, got some oxen, thought that'd be the faster way to get there, but that wasn't what God wanted. And as a result, there was death. But David decided the next time to follow what God's instructions were. So he got members of the Levite tribe, and the Levite tribe did what they were designed to do, what they were ordered to do by God. They put the ark on their shoulders with sticks, and as a result, they carried the ark back safely to that place. But now David knew that he was in the will of God, and as a result of being in the will of God, the movement of the ark was not a sorrowful occasion. It was a joyful occasion. So before we get to the 30th Psalm, I just got to take a moment to do a little commercial right here to explain this. Sometimes when we do what the world wants us to do, it may seem expedient, but oftentimes it comes at a perilous price. And as we do what God designs and determines us to do, even though it may seem like it's a lot of work or a lot of effort, what we realize is when we put the effort into doing God's stuff versus doing the worldly stuff, which may seem good, we find ourselves ultimately blessed. The Bible says that when David brought the Ark of the Covenant back the way that God had designed it, that every six steps, think about this, every six steps, they would pause, and he would really build an altar, and they would worship the Lord. And David, over the period of time when this was taking place, as they moved this Ark of the Covenant, David became so excited and so joyful and so connected to God that he was practically, well, matter of fact, and they say practically, it's about this, he was dancing as they brought the Ark into the city. His wife, Saul's daughter, despised David because of his exuberance toward the Lord. But what we realize, and I like to tell this part of the story as well, Michael was barren, and her barrenness came from her inability to understand the significance of a child of God worshiping the God that they serve and the God who had created them, and most importantly, the God who had created a relationship with them because of his good pleasure. And so remember that when we are walking through doing the world, doing what God has called us to do, let us always do the way God wants us to do it. Let us not be cheapened. Let's not allow worship to be cheapened because it's expedient what the world says. Let us make sure that we put our all into what God has called us to do. Let me give you one example, and I'm going to get off our text for tonight. Let us be careful that when we worship God, let it be something that we do at home. Let us not wait to be fired up by a song. Let us not wait to be fired up because the world has tried to design, even using biblical methods, even using things that appeal to us, I should say that, that try to cause us to let worship just take place in church. But let me tell you, worship is not just take place in church. Worship ought to take place in your house. Worship ought to take place in your car, at your job, wherever. God deserves to be worshiped. He certainly deserves to be praised as well. So let us put the effort into it like David did and watch the outcome of our efforts in praising and worshiping God. Let us not postpone it. Let us not minimize it. Let us not marginalize it. Let us do things the way God wants us to do so that we can experience the fullness of God and without any of the perilous side effects that come with doing things our way or the world's way. So as a result of what we just talked about, bringing the ark back to the place of God, the place that David had ordained it so that the presence of God would be in the presence of the people. David penned Psalm 30. Psalm 30 was written, again, it's inspired by the Holy Spirit of God, but it spoke through the prism of God, of David's experience with the Lord. In other words, God initiated and made these words manifest through David, but it was spoken through the prism of David's experience so that David felt these words, so they were coming out of his mouth and through his hand into the pen. These words were meaningful to David, but at the same time, they were ordained by God. So look at the 30th Psalm. We're just going to do a few verses tonight. We'll finish up this week. He starts off by saying, I will extol thee, O Lord. Let's stop there. I will extol thee. I will exalt thee. I will lift you up. I will declare your name. We learn these words now. David says, I will lift up your name. I will declare your grace. I will declare your power. I will declare your sovereignty. I will declare all that you are, God. And at the same time, Lord, I will give credit to you because of all that you've done. And I want to watch this. David didn't say he was doing this because he felt like it. David had made a determination in his heart that he would, in fact, extol God. In other words, David said, you know what? Looking back over the situation, recognizing how important it is to give God praise, I'm just going to determine that a part of my life, David said, I might have to go to the palace and work. I might have to see about my kids. I might have to do all these things. But more importantly, that which covers all this, David said, I'm going to praise the Lord. And I think that's a posture. And that's a position that each of us as children of God ought to have. We ought to determine that we're going to praise God. If it's going good, we praise God. We just talked about that last week in 1 Thessalonians. It is God's will that those who are in Christ Jesus thank him in all things. And likewise, we ought to make that a determination. If you're going to get up in the morning, I know I start planning my breakfast around about 12 o'clock midnight. I said, before I go to sleep, I said, let me see about what I'm going to eat for breakfast. Maybe I have a bowl of cereal. Maybe I have a little cream of wheat. I don't know. Maybe I have cheese toast. Maybe I have a big breakfast and have some pancakes. Whatever it is, I determine so I can go ahead and outline things in my head for how I need to proceed the first thing in the morning. I have to determine what everybody else wants to eat, but I determine most first and foremost what I want to get, what I want to eat. But I also need to let's understand before you determine what you're going to eat, before you determine what you're going to wear, you ought to determine, you ought to decide, I am going to give God praise. When I get up in the morning, because God watched over me all that long, I determined, I have deliberated, and I've made a decision that what I'm going to do is extol the Lord. I'm going to give him the praise and the glory and honor. David said that before he even tells why he's going to do it. He said, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to praise the Lord. I'm not going to say God has done this, so I'm going to praise the Lord. David says, I'm going to praise the Lord, and then I'm going to determine what list of praises I need to give him for that day. And this is what David says, and I want to say that right there again. David didn't let what God has done dictate. He decided he was going to praise God, knowing that each day his notebook full of praise might be full of one thing. He said, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to get this, I'm going to praise the Lord, and then I determine what it is I'm going to praise God for. He moves on. And says, and the next thing he says, I will extol thee, O Lord. He's speaking to God now. Lord, I'm going to give you all the honor and the glory and exaltation you deserve, for thou hast lifted me up. I can imagine that David was sad. Now, this is important right here in verse 2, so we may not get as far as I meant tonight. In verse 1, rather. David says, Lord, you have lifted me up. David was sorrowful. David was sad. David was upset. David was disappointed. In regards to the death of Uzzah, as he was trying to bring the Ark of the Covenant to the place in which it was designed, which it was determined that it would be, so there could be a corporate worship in Israel. He was hurt. He was down. Now, let me pause again and remind you, the reason why the Philistines tried to take the Ark of the Covenant, because they had realized that the Ark of the Covenant was synonymous, or the presence of God, rather, was synonymous with Israel's victory. They knew that Israel's strength was not based upon Israel's hand, that Israel's strength was based upon God's hand. And so they tried to get the ark, thinking they got the ark, they could somehow or another usurp God's power operating on behalf of Israel. They thought that God was confined to an ark, but they did not realize that God was represented by the ark, but God was not confined by anything, because God is omnipotent, omniscient, and omnipresent, and sovereign. So all they did was they took the Ark of the Covenant and tried to hide the Ark of the Covenant, but they found out that God's presence and power was not limited to the Ark. It was that God's power was everywhere, and Israel was still victorious because of the presence of God. Let me pause and say that again. Now, some folks want you to think that we don't go to church, that we're not in the building, that we're going to be weak. And no, I think we've got strong as we have been disconnected from the building. I don't mean I want to go back. I want to go back to the building. But I'm going to be patient and allow God to do his thing so that we can experience what God wants us to experience where we are right now. In other words, the building is not the power for the church. The presence of God is the power for the church. And as a result of Jesus Christ's sacrificial death on the cross, the presence of God rests where you are, where we are, in the hearts and minds of the believers, in the hearts of the believers. So I say this to say, David was down, but David was lifted up. And this next part tells us why he said this. Lord, you have not allowed my foes to rejoice over me. I'm sure that when those who are watching, be rest assured that when the ark was being moved, that the Philistines and every other pagan nation were watching. When the ark, when the man was killed, all the other nations probably were looking. Said, "Ooh, look at what happened to them. They're not going to make it now because they ain't got the ark with them." They were probably casting the aspersions toward Israel, particularly at David. But David said, God, you have lifted me up. I was down. And David didn't say, God, you the reason I was down because you killed us. David said, I was down. And that's something important. David did a self-evaluation and said, I was down, God. But what I recognize, Lord, is you lifted me up. And you have not made my foes rejoice over me. You did not allow Philistines, the Moabites, and the Hivites, everybody who was ever around, God, you did not allow them to cast dispersion on me. You did not allow them to be victorious on me. You did not let me lose, Lord. Despite what I did that was wrong, you did not allow me to lose. And I love that right there. David said, God, I was wrong, but you didn't let my wrong be to my destruction. You caused my wrong to be a learning experience for me so that I could be restored and I could experience the victory that you have in my life. How about that, St. Peter Missionary Baptist Church and all of our friends and believers on this line? How about that? God, because of his great mercy and his compassion, even in our mistake, and I know somebody that I'm talking about, I know, I'm raising my hand, I do, that even when we mess up, God's power and God's love and God's kindness and God's care and God's concern for us, his people, is so great that he does not allow us to fail because of our failure, but he sets us up so that we can learn from our mistakes if we are sensitive to his word. That's how David learned the difference between what happened the first time and what happened the second time. What? It was the word of God. He went back to the word. Let me tell somebody this right here. When you find yourself faltering and not knowing which way to go, guess what you need to find? Don't find Wikipedia. Don't find Google. Find the word of God, because in the word of God, there's place for correction and direction in conjunction with the Holy Spirit so that you will know where it is God wants you to be. So David was simply rejoiced in Psalm 30 verse 1 because the Lord had brought him up out of his funk, his spiritual depression because of what had happened, and also because God had not allowed his foes to have victory over him. Sometimes we allow our mistakes to bury us, even though God ain't trying to bury us in our mistakes. But David said, God, you would let me be buried. You brought me back around. You lifted me up. You took the veil over from my eyes, and you allowed me to see you and your will. And as a result, God, I'm going to praise your name. Look at verse 2. Then he says, not only, Lord, did you bring me or lift me up even when I was down, and not only, Lord, did you keep my foes from rejoicing over me. Verse 2, David says, oh, Lord, my God, I cried unto thee, and thou hast healed me. David's hurt and pain caused him to have not necessarily a physical pain or physical breach in his body, but a spiritual breach. He was a little turned around. He was a little disconnected because he didn't understand why God did what God did. But David said, God, I cried out to you, and I can imagine during the interim time between the bringing of the ark initially and the successful entrance of the ark into the place of worship, that David had cried to the Lord, Lord, what did I do? Lord, what did I do wrong? But let me stop right here and tell you that is the position that all of us, the children of God, have. When we find ourselves disconnected from God, we find our place not understanding what happened in our lives spiritually, we ought to call on God. God, please tell me what I did. Help me. Give me direction. Give me guidance. Sometimes in our selfishness, in our self-centeredness, in our capacity to just depend on self, we find ourselves missing out on the correction that God could provide. In other words, if we mess up, we rather sit, you know, in time out, put ourselves in time out, and miss on what it is that God really wants us to do, as opposed to crying out to God, asking for mercy from God, so that God can get us on the right track. When I was a little boy, I used to have these, and some of us probably remember these little cards. Either you had them, or you, some kids, or some other kids had them. There was these little cards you put on the track. And it was a magnet in the car that held them in the little slot. And you would push the little button, and they would go around. But every now and then, they would come off track. And when they would come off track, the car had no capacity. It was just that you could push the button down, and it would just spin their wheels. It wasn't until you physically placed the car back in the slot where the magnet held it into place that the car would get back to going around the circle, whatever configuration it was in. Sometimes we get off track spiritually, but what the magnet is for us is not a physical magnet. It's a spiritual magnet for us. What centers us and what guides us is our connection and commune with God through the word of God. And so when you get off track, don't just stand there with your wheels spinning. Get back in the word of God. Get back in the conversation, commune with God, so that God can get you back on track, so that by his power that he can move you to where he wants you to go in the course of your life. So that's what David is praising God for. That's why he said, I'm praising you, Lord. Lord God, because you, when I cry to you, you heal me. You heal my spiritual needs. You heal me. And let me pause and go back and say this. God is a healer in every capacity that we as his creations and his children need healing. If you have a broken watch, where do you go? To the watchmaker. If you have a broken car, where do you go? You go to the mechanic. If you have an appliance broken, you call somebody who specializes in appliances. If you got a water problem in your house, you call a plumber. If you got an electrical problem, you call an electrician. But let me tell you something. If your body is aching, if your body is broken, if your body is in a problem, guess who? You call your creator. You got a full-time warranty through Jesus Christ, by whose stripes we are healed, for your healing. But likewise, when we have spiritual issue, guess what? Emotion issue. We still, God is the place we need to go. Because if God is the author of creator of our physical body, he's the author and finisher of our faith. And as a result, whatever we're going through, God is he whom can bring us and heal us in our spiritual and our emotional places as well. So David is simply saying, God, I called on you. I went to you. And you heal me. Let us remember, when we need healing, let us not sit and be sick spiritually or physically. Let us call on God so that we can experience the healing that only God can give. Let's go one more verse. I'm going to try to get us out of here on time, but I want to take my time here, these next two verses. Oh, Lord, verse 3, thou hast brought up my soul from the grave. David said, I felt dead. Lord, but you brought my soul up from the grave. Thou hast kept me alive that I should not go down to the pit. Now, I've been reading this scripture right here for a long time, but it wasn't until today that I understood the depth of this particular script verse. Oh, Lord, he says, thou hast brought up my soul from the grave. In other words, David was admitting that spiritually, and probably in his poem, as he thought about it, even several times he was physically about to die. In other words, he was, picture this, David is saying, I was at the graveside. I was boxed up and I was ready to be lowered into the ground, Lord, but you brought me up from the grave. You not only brought me up from the grave, you kept me from dying, but you also kept me alive. That's two different things. Because there's a place between dying and living that some of us as Christians find ourselves in just existing. There's no purpose, there's no power, there's no communion with God. People are just existing. But David said, God, you brought me from the grave, then you kept me alive. You gave me that which causes me to live, to be aware, God, of who you are, to be aware of your power, to be aware of your presence, to be aware of your love, to be aware of all that you are doing in my life. David said, God, you did that for me as well. So you brought me from my soul from the grave. You kept me alive. But this next part is key. Not only that, Lord, but I should not go down to the pit. God, you kept me alive. So what David was talking about first was just death. Now he's talking about hell. God, not only did you keep me from dying and you brought me back to life, but God, you kept me and you have kept me, and it's you as the reason why I would not go down to the pit. When he said the pit, he's talking about hell. He's talking about eternal disconnection from God. And so David got excited. David could have said, God, I don't know where I was headed, but God, you kept me. You brought me from the grave. You kept me from death that was seemingly in my face. Then you brought me back to life, physically and spiritually. And then, Lord, because of you, that hell is not in my view. There's no pit in my view. And so David says, because of that, God, I give your name the praise. I extol you daily in my life because you have done these things. And let us be grateful, the children of God, that we have been spared death. Even when we die physically, we live spiritually because of what God has done for us through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And not only that, but because in this world, all of us who are saved have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. We are alive. You remember what Jesus said? He said, I came that you might have life. How? Life more abundantly. We get to experience the fullness of God through Jesus Christ. And so not only are we not dead, but we are alive in Christ. And now we know that we do not have to face the wrath of God and death in the pit, but instead we face the love of God and eternity with God in heaven in his presence. David says, Lord, I thank you for that. I praise your name for that. Verse 4, he says, now look at that. I love him. You remember all the Psalms we read of David. Two things David did. He lifted up the name of the Lord, and he asked and challenged and encouraged and besought everybody else to do the same thing. Look at verse 4. Sing unto the Lord, O ye saints of his. He said, y'all, come on. He said, come on with me, saints. Come on with me, St. Peter. Sing unto the Lord, O saints, and give thanks to the remembrance of his holiness. He said, St. Peter, people of Israel, believers everywhere, remember how holy God is. Remember his acts of holiness. Remember the things that he has done that demonstrate how holy he is, how he has brought us out of death through Jesus Christ, how he has delivered us into a new place, how even right now God is working on us so that he can present us holy and faultless before his throne in that day. He says, join in and just sing praise unto the Lord and thank God for what he is doing right now and he has done out of his acts of holiness. He said, remember. Can I tell some child of God, one of the best things we can do is remember what God has done. Don't ever forget what God has done. Don't ever allow it to happen. The enemy tries to erase the memories of God's blessing. The enemy wants us to forget about where God has brought us from. But I tell you, if you remember, that's what you will find yourself uplifted, strengthened, and ready for the next challenge. And so David says, come on with me. Let's sing this together. But this last verse is where I want to park, and I'm going to put a park in this after this verse. Verse 5, David says, saints, give thanks to the remembrance of his holiness. He said, remember how holy God is. Remember how wonderful God is. But remember this right here. God is not only holy, but he's compassionate. Look at verse 5. For God's anger endureth but a moment. He said, God does have anger because he's holy, because he's righteous. But remember this, people of God, his anger endureth but a moment. It only lasts a little while. Here's why this is important that David says this. David says his anger lasts for a while because God is holy and God at the same time is compassionate. His holiness causes him to have to respond to our errors, our sins, our transgressions. If he has to. Why? Because God is holy. But because God loves us, his people. Now, David's talking about God's people now. He said his anger lasted only for a minute because God, even as he chastises us, is ready to do what? To bring us back to him. A parent who loves their child will discipline their child, but at the same time they discipline their child, they're ready to restore their child to their fellowship. The discipline may be a whipping. The discipline may be a punishment. The discipline may be, in my case, the most interesting punishment I ever got. My dad stopped speaking to me for 2 weeks. I'll never forget it. I was in 10th grade, and I had gone out Matter of fact, I was in 11th grade, and I thought I was grown. That's when I just outgrew my daddy, and I was a little taller than him. And I never forget, it was cold outside. Football season was over. I think it was a little snow on the ground. And I went out and played football all day with my friends, and we went down to Fulton and Dutchman, got us some crystals, and he hung out, and I came back in by 8 o'clock that night, and it was dark outside. I ain't talking to my mom or dad all day. So I came back in the house and said, my dad said, where you been? I said, why? Now, why did I say why? I'm going to start trying to figure that one out. Well, all I know is by the time my dad came across the room at record speed and disciplined me strongly, I should say, and once I climbed up off the ground and dusted off the potted plant, saw a potting soil off my body because he had knocked me over the potted plant, for 2 weeks he didn't talk to me. And that hurt worse than the beating. It hurt worse than the discipline I got because our fellowship was broken. And I love talking to my dad, and he loved talking to me. But he did it, and went back to the end of the second, we got to daddy, please, I'm sorry, please stop by talking to me. I will never do that again. I will never ask you why, and I will never go nowhere all day. And he hugged me, and we were back in our fellowship. This is what David is saying, the same thing about God. His anger endures for a moment, but in his favor is life. I was my daddy's child, and he had brought me back in. We are God's children. What would he do? He'll bring us back in. In his favor is life. In a relationship with God, we experience his favor, and in that favor, in that grace, which what we don't deserve, God allows us to have an abundance of life and experience with him. He says, weeping may endure for a night. Can I tell somebody, weeping happens. In this world, we're going to cry sometimes. In this world, we're going to have difficulty. In this world, we're going to have trials and tribulations. But because of God, because God's anger endures only for a moment, and because in his favor, which is in the other hand, God's discipline comes with this hand, but God's favor comes with the other hand. Remember, love and kindness, they are God's instruments for correcting and directing his people. David says, weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. In other words, as we are children of God, remember this, as we are in a relationship with God, yes, there may be times because of what has happened in our lives that we didn't have nothing to do with, or what happened in our lives because we had something to do with. We may find ourselves crying. But the good news is because in God's favor there is life, God will bring us joy in the morning. That means a new day is dawning for those of us as we continue in our relationship with God. Just like I went back to dad and said, dad, come on, let's talk. Please let me talk. I'll do whatever. If we are in a supple relationship with God where we are pliable so that God can move us and strengthen us and correct us and direct us, guess what? We'll find out the same thing about God, that God will put his arms around us and bring us back into fellowship with him, and all the tears will be over. That the weeping moment be over, that nighttime in our lives be over, and that new day will come as we are renewed in our fellowship with God. I'm going to call a timeout tonight because I can keep going, but I want to call a timeout. But think about this as we look at this Psalm 30. David is excited about coming to a place to worship God. He's excited about a place where he can, where the people can experience the presence of God by way of the Ark of the Covenant and the obedience that the people would do so they could experience the presence of God. And as he did this, even all that he had been through, the hurt and pain that he had felt, was taken away because he recognized just how good God has been. And so I want us to recognize the beauty of what God is doing with us right now. Me and Pastor Harris and Pastor Gaddis and Pastor Hampton had a long conversation last night about what God was doing and training his people to do. And I want us to understand this season was not accidental. It was not caused by the Chinese president. This is what God has allowed to happen so that we, his people, could be strengthened, so that we be prepared for what he wants us to do next. Do not take this. Do not allow this to make you depressed. Do not allow quarantine and all these things that make you depressed. Let it be a place where you can grow strong in the Lord. If you hadn't done it yet, go ahead and do it right now. Focus yourself and commit yourself verbally to God by talking to him, and then commit yourself to God experientially by actually doing what it is that God wants you to do. I love each of you tonight, and I thank God for your calls in tonight on the Zoom crew and the phone crew. God bless you. And let us close in prayer tonight, and I pray that God would bless all of us individually, that we may grow closer to him and experience his fullness. I pray that God would let us know for a fact that we may endure for a night, but the joy coming to the morning, so that none of us will give up or give out during the tough moments in life. And I pray even beyond that, that God would allow us to know and operate in the will and the way he wants us to operate. Let us pray. Father God, tonight we just come to say thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy, which you give us new every day. We thank you for your compassion, because we know, Lord, because of your compassion, Lord, that we are saved from destruction. Lord, we thank you tonight, Lord, for allowing us to understand and be reminded again of what you do in our lives, Lord, that you do lift us up. You do keep up our foes from rejoicing over us. You do, Lord, just like you did for David. When we cry out to you, Lord, you heal us. You do, Lord. You have brought us up, our soul from the grave, from death. You have given us life in Jesus Christ. And, Lord, if you've taken hell out of the equation for us. Lord, we thank you then we know now that your anger endures just for a while, and that is anger is your anger is to discipline us, Lord, to correct us. But we thank you, allow us to know that in your favor is life, and even though we may endure for a night, we know now that joy comes in the morning. Lord, help us to seek you and love you and trust you and depend on you in everything. God, I pray tonight that you would allow these words to get in our ears, that we may hear it daily. Let your word get in our feet so that we may walk it out in every aspect of our lives. Let your word, Lord, get in our minds so we can think about it. Lord, let your word get in our hearts so we may be strengthened by it. Let your word get in our mouths, Lord, so that we can declare it to a dying world, declare it to other believers, and declare it to ourselves, we may encourage ourselves in you. I pray, God, a special prayer tonight upon all the believers that are on the Zoom call and on the phone call, that we may be blessed by your presence and great understanding of your word tonight. And I pray, God, that from that understanding, Lord, that the households and the families that are represented here tonight may be blessed, Lord, because we share your word with them. It is in the name of Jesus, that name that is above every name, the only name by which man may be saved. It is in Jesus' name we say thank you, Lord, and amen. God bless y'all tonight. God bless you, phone crew. God
bless you. Amen. 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 Amen.